What is up, everybody? Happy Thanksgiving. We're getting into December. It was Thanksgiving a couple days ago, and the next day I saw Christmas ornaments all over the place. It was as if people had that prepared, or maybe they were up on Thanksgiving. I don't know, but it's like the collapsing of time and space. We need to allow some space in between these things. It kind of feels like how the marching season is. There's no off time, really. You know, right now we're kind of in between competitive seasons. Marching band is wrapped up, at least from a competitive standpoint. The planning goes year round, and we are kind of in the planning and teaching and designing part of the indoor season, which competitively kicks off, as we know, around that February mark for everybody. Guard might start a little earlier some places around the country, but for drumline, it's start competing in February, at least where we are. So it's a super exciting time of the year. No one's announced much yet. Everyone's pretty quiet. At one point, we were all announcing super early. Now it feels like everyone's waiting longer. So we're definitely going to wait longer to announce the GMU show, just to, we don't want to be the first out. But we're super excited about what we're doing. And it's, you know, another amazing season with that group. And I'm very excited to see what everyone's doing. And as things trickle out into the kind of, cybersphere. And that's very relevant to our guest today in terms of media, in terms of things leaking out and breaking things first. We have someone, a personal friend of mine, that I wanted to get on here to chat today. Today's guest has been an active member of the marching arts since 2010. Throughout his time, he was a performer, educator, a manager, a coordinator, and continues to combine his skill in documentation and media creation with the marching arts. He's been involved with ensembles like Pulse, the Mandarins, SCV, University of Nevada, Reno, and many more. Our guest is the proud owner and operations manager of the marching arts community and media production company, Marching Vlogs, and continues to educate at a local high school in Southern California. Everyone help me welcome Sergio Bravo. Sergio, what's up? How we doing, dude?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me here.
Dude, I'm excited to get you on. I always love having media people on because I kind of get to just get a little masterclass. And I think what got me excited for us to jump on specifically was I saw y'all hit 100,000 followers on Instagram. Like, talk to me about that. Was that a surprise? Has there been like a groundswell in the last year? Because that feels like I remember when y'all were just kicking off and now you're like, you're at 100. So talk to me about that.
Yeah, no, it's been cool. I think like the actual growth, at least in terms of like followers for Marching Vlogs, is really just took off in the last, I'd say, 6 months. So it's been cool to see that growth happen so quickly. But, you know, to be honest with you, Marching Vlogs has been going on for like, I think 3 years running now, mm-hmm. almost four. So the first, you know, first more than half of that inception has kind of just been a grind. And, you know, regardless of the followers, it's been fun. So it's been cool to see the activity grow in the last 3 to 4 years and just still be involved since I started it after I aged out. So it's been cool, man. 100,000 followers is a cool thing.
That's a lot in the marching arts. That is especially a lot. I have heard that I think in total we have something like 400,000 fans, period. So you might have a quarter of them following you on Instagram along with the other platforms. So that's kind of a crazy thing to think about. And I know I try not to think too much about, you know, that type of thing and overthinking the reach and things like that. But what about the last 6 months has specifically gotten things popping? Is it just like all these different plates that you were spinning and sort of these different ideas you had, they're all running full steam now? Like, why the last 6 months have you just seen this like huge uptick?
Well, primarily the growth has been on Instagram. So I guess the last year has just been interesting to watch because of the things we've done at Marching Vlogs to kind of change. Like, we've been, at least for me, I've been thinking about like how the algorithm works and how to reach more people, not just the marching people, but how am I going to tackle, you know, kind of a wider audience. And of course, still adhere to the niche of marching arts, and pertain to the people that actually know what's happening. But I think, you know, with the growth on Instagram, like, people love watching lot videos in particular, and And I think more so the people in our activity love hearing the interviews that go on because we actually know the people that are talking. So a mixture of those two things, kind of getting the people that are part of the arts to be on the content of marching blogs, but also documenting and showing off kind of like how much talent is in the activity, and how much work is being put in to like execute at a high level that all these groups tend to do, you know? So yeah, the last year is just, it's been different because of the way we've been attacking the algorithm on Instagram anyway.
So is this your full-time role? Have you like turned this into a full-time job, or are you working on the side as well?
Full-time, no. I would love it to be. I would love to just like spend all my time doing this. But no, I'm primarily an educator. I'm a drummer myself. So I teach at a high school, and I used to teach at more, but I think it's been nice to just kind of focus on the one gig that I have and kind of turn more of my attention to marching vlogs.
Right.
But yeah, teaching, and also I'm still a waiter, very, very part-time to subsidize some bills, but yeah.
I feel you. Yeah, you need some tax dollars happening there, so that's important. Are you self-taught with all this stuff? Because it seems like you have a really good understanding or instinct for it. Is this what you went to school for? Or did you just kind of figure out the social media content creation thing kind of naturally?
That's interesting you asked that. I did not go to school for any media creation or anything. I've just been a really big fan of the marching arts since I grew up in it and kind of find my way in the world with marching arts. I feel like a lot of us who stick around tend to do that, whether it's through teaching or other avenues. But yeah, no, I've just been a huge fan. I was a big proponent of documenting my own summer. Mm. So during my age out, I was really focused on making sure that I had something to do when I left and I aged out, and I could look back kind of like a journal. Yeah. I did that through Instagram and just like recording my daily activities in drum corps and indoor. And after I aged out, I wasn't really interested in vlogging like my own life. So I turned to media creation in the marching arts, and it kind of just meshed together. All the videography and all the photography that I've learned throughout the years all came after I created marching vlogs. So it's not like I was this videographer who wanted to shoot drums and document the arts. I had a love for the marching arts, and I found a way to kind of enhance my skills and bring more of that to light. That's kind of what, you know, brought marching vlogs to life, was the love for the arts and then learning all the skills to bring that out to the world.
That's really interesting. That I don't think people would assume that looking at what you're doing, because it's so polished and you just have a solid brand. Like, I really feel like y'all have that solid idea of what kind of voice you have and the type of personality that you provide to the marching arts, specifically with the takeovers. And it's your whole thing with when you're marching and creating this video journal. I mean, that's essentially what those takeovers are, but then you're casting this net over every group with including everyone that wants to do it, basically, right? I think you basically are like, let's get as many people involved. Let's, you know, it's like more is almost more. And we can talk more about how you coordinate that, of course, but it's like, I feel like that sounds a lot like what you sort of did naturally back then. But to hear that you learned your technical skills as you were building the online brand and putting it out there it's pretty wild. But it's like, you have a target, you have something around. So it's, instead of like, I'm going to become a content creator, you're like, I have marching vlogs, and in order to make marching vlogs work, I need to learn how to like edit and turn over video like pretty quickly, right?
Yeah, exactly. You're spot on pretty much. I mean, I had a little bit of a knack for video editing and like, you know, doing the social media thing for myself, but I didn't have a niche or anything. I was just kind of doing what everyone else does with social media. I just post what I do in my daily life. But the idea of like documenting my age out came when someone told me, like, wouldn't it be cool if we got an inside look of someone's experience every day in drum corps? Like, can you go anywhere online and kind of like look at someone's entire summer? And there's avenues to that. Like, people do the lots, and people do, you know, they interview directors and designers and techs and all this stuff, but no one really sees like a video journal of somebody's experience through drum corps. And us in the marching arts, we get it. We've done it. But when you're like trying to tell somebody that isn't involved, like what this is, you kind of have to go through so many explanations. Like, wait, you get paid for this? Like, you stay in a gym for how long? Like, so it was just interesting to me. I'm like, that's a crazy idea. I'm aging out. I might as well try this. Like, I might as well have something that I can look forward to when I'm older. And I can look back on my youth in the marching arts when I was still marching. And it's fun though. I can still go on that Instagram account that I made called Sergio Boy Vlogs. And I can scroll through the highlights, and I have day zero all the way to like day 78. And when I click on day zero, like, you can just see everybody's skin is so bright. But by the end of like day 79, everybody's dark. And it's just cool to kind of see the progression of everybody's like physical features. And how tired everybody looks on finals day, but
that's a little scary. Yeah. I was just thinking, like, it'd be super cool if you could get someone or like one member of each drum corps to take a 1 minute video of themselves like every day. So you have like every drum corps, and it's like, you could post, you know, or maybe it's not even a minute. Maybe it's like, you know, however long a reel is, a minute and a half, you're able to like edit them all together. And it's like this day-to-day thing. It's like, okay, maybe it's not a minute and a half video of each person. Maybe each person, like, it's like one word to describe each day. And then you can see, like, it'd be like every drum corps would be like hot, tired, exhausting, like all this stuff. But it would also be like some highs in there. Like, it'd be kind of a social experiment, because it reminded me of the photo montage kind of projects people do when they take a picture of themselves every day for like 10 years and then they just go,
oh yeah.
If you could do that with tour, but in a more like, you know, TikTok friendly way, that'd be pretty sick. And it would be like, because what you're doing is you're giving this insight into like the real situation, rather than like, because even the lot videos are glamorous and glamorizing, whereas like something about the takeovers you guys do that I really like, and I kind of want to emulate with like, you know, the groups that I have any influence over, is like the personalities behind the groups, seeing the members not drumming. We see them all drum. Okay. Zach is the center of Blue Coats, and then like Elijah is the center of Blue Devils, whatever. It's like, see them drumming the videos. It's like, I want to see like what they're like that allows them to prosper in these settings. And I love the takeovers about that. So before, I guess, you know, we're kind of talking about the origins of marching vlogs, right? But how did you like come up with this? Was it always about like, we're going to provide this like different entry? Did you experiment? Like, did you always know you were going to be more about video creation? Like, sort of what was the vision you had early up, or did it develop? Talk to me a little bit about how you developed to this point.
Yeah. So I guess I already kind of went through like how I came up with the idea, but I'll talk about how I solidified the brand itself.
Right.
So after I aged out, because I did takeovers for both Mandarins when I aged out in 2018, and then when I did Pulse Percussion in 2019, I also vlogged that on a separate like Instagram channel. And like I kind of said already, I didn't want to vlog my life, but over those seasons, like, people came through my DMs and was like, dude, I really loved seeing an inside look on what it's like to be at one of the top indoor groups. Like, and I knew that that would be valuable, because when I was a kid, like, I remember looking up to these groups and thinking, how intimidating, like, how cool are these guys, and how talented are these folks to just be executing like they do on the first try. Like, I just thought it was so like out of this world. So I knew that there was a value there, and I know doing that through my own vlogs was something I could give back to the community without, like, I don't know, doing too much, because it was already part of what I was doing on the weekends. You know, I just had to pull my camera out and share it. And then, so anyway, after I aged out, Gridbook, or more specifically Mark Perret, has been very vocal about how much he enjoyed the idea that I was doing with my own vlogs. So he had this, he pretty much just messaged me going, wouldn't this be cool if this was in a centralized like brand? Like, what if we got, you know, who would be down to make a Instagram account just for takeovers, just to like see the process of different ensembles? And I was like,
yeah,
I'll do it. So yeah, that's kind of how it started. It was just a conversation between me and Mark Perret. And if you didn't know, and even for the viewers watching, like, Gridbook used to do this thing where they did Snapchat takeovers back in the day, like maybe a couple of years before I started marching vlogs. And he, Mark Perret, would tell me all the time how logistical that process was, like how much more of a nightmare it was in terms of like getting them on board and making sure they knew the rules and what to do and what not to do. And, you know, who would be the right person to take over? How would we represent the brand properly? How would we represent the ensemble properly? So I didn't realize at the time that it was going to be like a logistical nightmare.
Yeah.
But I can now tell you that it is a process to get somebody on the big leagues. So the origin, my vlogs, then Mark Rett hit me up. And then honestly, when we were talking about it, I was like, what would be a good name for this? He was like, dude, Marching Vlogs is literally not taken. And so I just made the Gmail right then and there. We made the Instagram like the same day. And then we started planning for like, you know, what it could be. We started off with a basic idea. We started with five different members from different drum corps to take over for 7 days. Mm-hmm. So the cool thing about what I did when I was marching was you could see the whole summer. Right. It was kind of like a day in, day out experience. I could imagine some kid opening up their phone and going, Sergio Boy Vlogs. Interesting. What's going on today?
Right.
And you kind of lose that when you're not doing it for more than like a period of time. So I thought it would be a good place to start would be 7 days at five different drum corps. And we would launch it 5 weeks before DCI finals. So we had talked about this before the summer even started, but that was our target date. It was going to be 5 weeks before DCI finals, and we were going to get a week and plan it all out. And it was a huge success, to be honest. I think after we released our first post introducing what Marching Vlogs was, we already had, you know, the idea and the plan and the people in place to kind of make that first season happen. And to be honest with you, I didn't know what was going to happen after that. Mm-hmm. I just thought like, hey, let's do this for the indoor too. And that's kind of when things started to just, I was like, man, this is going to be a bigger deal. I think I'm going to stick with this for a little bit. Cause one thing about me is I've always been very like interested in entrepreneurial endeavors. Like I have a knack for wanting to do business and stuff like that, but I just didn't have anything. I didn't have an idea. And so Marching Vlogs to me was like the perfect brainchild. It was like, this is the marching arts and there's like an entrepreneurial endeavor that that can mesh together and become something cool. I thought it was a no-brainer, so I just kind of ran with it since then, and now we're almost 4 years into it. So
I like the name. I think the name was on point. It's like, what is this? It's Marching Vlogs, and it's super just, I don't know, it applies across a lot, which I think is super dope. And I mean, it sounds like you know, of course we can talk about content creation, but it's like the content strategy part of it is so crucial. And, you know, I've seen what FloMarching does in every season. And it's like, you take any given season and you have an understanding of how the preseason breaks down, how the competitive season breaks down. And then you can kind of play with that creatively as the content strategist and be like, hey, like, it's really fun to see behind the scenes before the shows even hit the floor, before the uniforms are on. It's like, that's a really awesome part of the year. And for the anyone who's not in it, they're not part of that. So I actually think like what you do, what Flo does as well, you know, what we all do is extend the season out a little bit, extends the reach a little bit from like a time standpoint. And it just, it's like, hey, like this is happening almost all year round and you can engage with the marching arts all year round. And I think that's kind of an interesting behind the scenes part of it that you don't necessarily think about because so much overlap. And that leads me to just ask you, and I was wondering, you know, because I was, you know, thinking going into an episode today, I was like, oh, it's kind of a weird part of the year. Like no one's actually competing right now. So for Marching Vlogs, like what does a week right now, this time of year, you know, November 30th look like? What does your day-to-day kind of look like? How much time are you putting into it so that you can keep the ball rolling and keep things happening?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, Marching Vlogs, since I'm just doing it in my bedroom, it's like I could just do whatever whenever. And that's like honestly the biggest challenge of something like this. Like when I have a job that someone adheres me to, it's kind of like I have a regime and something I have to get done. But with Marching Vlogs, it's always just kind of like, what do I do to keep this thing going? And to answer that, there's a few things that kind of continue no matter what. And the takeovers are obviously one of those things. Like, it started the whole brand and it continues to be probably the most consistent form of content that Marching Vlogs makes. And only because mainly I don't have to make the content. Like, somebody else is going out there and getting the content for Marching Vlogs, which I think is a really smart content strategy.
Yeah.
If you find a way for your viewers to make the content for the viewers, it's really just figuring out how to do that. And that's mainly what I am doing on the back end, is trying to find the vloggers, make sure that they are signing on to the account properly, making sure that they understand what it takes to have a good vlog. And, you know, logistically speaking, that's what my job is. You know, when you look at Marching Vlogs, you don't really see my face, like maybe a couple times, but I'm more so just the guy making all of that happen. So my week is like sitting at my computer, going on Instagram, kind of figuring out where people are at right now, who's marching where, who would be good for that. And over the, how many seasons do we have now? Like 6 or 7 seasons of takeovers. And I base seasons like WGI season, DCI season. Every season I have been kind of solidifying and making the process of logging someone on faster, easier, and less time consuming. So fun story, like when I first, the first season, oh my God, dude, I was literally spending so much time every morning. Like I was working throughout the day from like 10 a.m. and then I would teach at like 5 p.m. So I'd have two jobs, but every morning from like 7 a.m. to like 9:30, I would be on my computer figuring out how to get takeovers rolling, scheduling them, making sure they all have the passwords and changing the passwords at the right time. But yeah, now we're like season 7 and I have multiple spreadsheets, actually just one master spreadsheet, but within that spreadsheet, you know, I have links and quick access to literally everything I need to do to onboard someone. And if it doesn't seem like a lot, like I'll quickly go through what I have to do, right? I have to get them to apply, which gives me all of their basic information, right? I take that, and within that application, by the way, is kind of like an interview portion. Like, what is your highest priority? Like, the last thing I want is someone to take over and they're like not keeping up with the responsibilities of rehearsal. And then like the staff and everyone else is like, dude, what are you doing?
And then
he goes, oh, I'm doing marching vlogs. And then that looks bad on marching vlogs, right? So that honestly is my biggest fear. It's because I know what it takes to be in something like that. And I do not want marching vlogs to like be a distraction. So, you know, those are the things I think about when getting someone on, and that's part of the application process. There's strategic questions in that application that kind of gives me enough info to like realize if this person is going to be a solid vlogger, not just in terms of content, but in terms of keeping up with their own responsibilities, because that's honestly what's more important.
Right.
We have a privilege, and you know, we're privileged to see that the activity, but when they're actually working within it, that to me is just way more important. So, and then after that process, right, I look at that, see who would be good for it. And then I move them into another spreadsheet, which gives me information on like, how am I going to, you know, introduce this person? Where do they come from? Where are they marching? You know, stuff like what their Instagram handle is, their email. And just making sure that I have everything I need to give them the next thing, which is the contract. So I have them sign a contract, which makes them legally liable if anything goes wrong with marching vlogs. I give them all the pros to doing a takeover, but also all the like, you know, just be careful right now. Like you're representing your ensemble, you're representing marching vlogs, you're representing yourself. You don't want to ruin that. So, you know, there's just things within that contract that kind of give us the right to terminate or honestly sue them if they do anything wrong with the brand. Like if they delete everything, for example, right? Like as everything becomes more of an asset, there's kind of a little word in there or a little spot that goes like, you're legally liable when you have this account. Like, we will come after you. And I'm not trying to make it a bad thing, but it just needs to be needs to be said to protect not only marching blogs, but even the ensembles that are being represented. So it is quite the process to get them on. And to go back to your question, I've spent less and less time nowadays on that process and more about what else can marching blogs do.
Right.
Like, you know, like just because in the beginning, we didn't have any of the videos that are out now, like in terms of the lot videos or like the interviews or even marching blogs drumline, which came like, you know, a year or two after the inception. So it's more about kind of planning for the future and making sure that the current content is still being pushed out.
Absolutely. So when you talk about kind of your you know, management of all of this, you know, you're very much the coordinator and sort of the person moving things along and dictating kind of how the process actually happens. What are you just using from like a technical standpoint to make marching vlogs happen? You're talking about using spreadsheets and just sort of overseeing kind of that logistical side. What other tools do you utilize? Are you overseeing some kind of like social media planning system, or is everything done manually? How are you working across the, you know, variety of people that work under the marching vlogs umbrella? Just talk a little bit about how you do that.
Yeah, so this past year has been about expanding the team in my eyes, because I know, like, for myself, one day I don't want to be doing all this stuff all the time. Like, I'm already getting tired of some of the things that I'm doing. And I'm like, I don't see myself doing this forever. But that's where the expansion comes in. So like trying to delegate more people to do smaller tasks for marching vlogs has been a big thing. So in terms of like what we do, there's a few programs that I'm trying to use. Like, I utilize the Google ecosystem like crazy. Mm-hmm. Like, I try not to be on any hardware anymore, because if I'm going to be moving about, traveling or whatever, like, I need to just have access either on my phone or on my laptop. So the Google ecosystem has been huge for anything content wise. I use planning apps like later.com to make sure that I can sit down and plan content for the week. I also use Adobe products to make my videos and edit my photos. You know, Marching Vlogs is a legal entity, so I have, you know, banking systems in place and all these things to make sure that that's all good in terms of the legal aspect. But yeah, that's pretty much it. Like, Marching Vlogs also has weekly meetings that we have. That's been slowing down recently because of all the bands, finals but usually we have maybe about 1 to 2 hours that we all just kind of chat together and kind of talk about like the next week and see what we need to get done. For example, like, I have photographers that are homies of mine that are down for the cause. So whenever they have photos, when we have the meeting, that'll be their only job for those 2 hours, is like uploading photos and making captions. And maybe we don't talk about anything else, but those 2 hours kind of just like solidify and make sure that stuff is being done at Marching Vlogs. Cause, you know, if we don't talk or we don't meet, kind of things just get lost in text messages and stuff like that. So
you're basically running a company, right? I mean, that's kind of what it is. And, you know, obviously there must be some form of monetization coming in. How kind of where are things at with that? Are you generating income, and are you like profitable right now? Or are you able to like pay people? Are they doing it on a volunteer? Are you able to pay yourself? Because you said, you know, this would be great if you could turn this into a job. So it's like, if it's not yet, how do you foresee making it, you know, at least your job?
Yeah, that's a great question. Something I continue to try and figure out. And I think we're close. There's some things I'm trying to do next year that I won't spill the beans on too much, but I'm hoping it'll be the method of how we make money. But until we like really solidify that, I'm not too sure that's the avenue. But right now, in terms of how we make money, there's a few ways. Obviously, or maybe not so obvious, but ad content has been probably the most consistent way of making money. It's grown steadily, but I wouldn't say it's anything I could live off of anytime soon. The like, I know YouTubers and stuff can make lots of money on content, but I think you really need a lot of followers for that. Mm-hmm. And I would say I'm still in like the grind to make that happen. So ad revenue steadily growing, but not enough, I'd say. In terms of other ways we make money, I'm also a freelance videographer. So I take on jobs where they have me either shoot, edit, or both. For example, this past year in the summer, Vanguard found me through marching vlogs. They said they liked the way I work and how that has grown, and they think I'd be perfect to help document their season. So I run all of my business in terms of freelancing through the entity of marching vlogs. So that's the other way I make money. I'd say that's the more substantial way that marching vlogs makes money, because I honestly don't even pay myself out. Like, anything that gets put into the MV account is just rotated back into either buying more equipment or paying for the monthly upkeeps that it's causing.
Right, right. That's super cool though. So that's like a face of your business that's not as obvious, as that you actually sort of are able to go and almost consult with a group, or, you know, you're implanting marching vlog skill set and sort of understanding of how to create good content for the marching arts. And you're like, hey, I'm going to help Vanguard, for example. And it's a huge part of about growing them, just the marching arts reach, is like, it's not just the access makes them look cool as they deserve to look. Because if you have unbridled content creation and it's shitty, it's actually like worse, right? I mean, it's like, you know, we're like in the 90s with it in some of these ways. And I think that's a really cool side of it that I was not aware of. I thought y'all were kind of just on the, you know, kind of social media thing. And I think YouTube too, like you said, it's like probably need 1 million subscribers to make some substantial month to month money. So it's like, you know, I guess to get back to your point, in the way that you are kind of thinking about content, do you see yourself being able to grow your content in terms of its breadth, in terms of its kind of, you know, reach beyond the marching arts, so that you could see yourselves hitting like a million subscribers on YouTube? Like, how would you go about doing that?
Yeah, that's a great question. And if I knew the answer, I would jump on that like soon. But
what's your answer?
I guess, I don't know. The content thing is cool because it ends up being passive eventually, right? So you make all this content for however long, and the hope is people will still watch it in the future. And I think YouTube is a great place to do that. YouTube has become, what I've learned, the second biggest search engine on the internet.
Next to Google.
Next to Google. And it's funny because Google still owns YouTube. So, you know, it's all part of the same thing.
Yeah.
And I think that's where marching vlogs is kind of going towards. I think this next year, that's what, in terms of content, I'm trying to bank on more. And since we're talking about the money aspect, YouTube Shorts is going to be monetized soon. So I really am going to be banking on YouTube, I think, in the future. Because right now, Instagram is monetized through Reels, but YouTube Shorts, which is like the same kind of content, is not. So it's interesting. I think we're making more money on Instagram than YouTube, which is usually not the case for a lot of brands. But that's just because Reels is monetized.
How do they monetize the Reels? Just through like the amount of views? Because there aren't ads on Reels, are there?
Yeah, it's not clear to me exactly. I think there's like a fund that Instagram has that they have like this monthly, I think they get it through ads, but they don't show them in the Reels.
Right.
I don't know. I think when you scroll through Reels, sometimes you'll see an ad, but it looks like a Reel. So it doesn't feel like an ad, I guess. Because like on YouTube, the way you see ad is you click on a piece of content and then the ad plays on top of the content.
Right.
But with Reels, you kind of just get shown an ad or you get shown a video and it just all kind of looks the same. So I think that's where it is. Don't quote me on that. But there is a monthly limit to how much like we can make on Instagram. And you still have to get a ridiculous amount of views. I think we can make $8,500 if we reach 83 million views on Reels. And it is all based on how many views you get. So it's not like how many people look at the ad on your video like YouTube, but how many views does your actual reel get? That's how much is contributing to how much of the ad revenue we will be giving to you. So the more views we get in a month, the more money. So it's,
wow.
ever since we were monetized, and I still remember when we got monetized. We got monetized on Instagram like the day before WGI finals. It was like the time when I was with you at GMU. Like we went back to the place we were at in Dayton, and I got a little notification that says, you are now eligible for bonus in Reels. And I was like, dude, this is huge. So we posted a reel and we made like, it was stupid for how many views we got, but it was like $50 for a certain amount of views. And I was like, dude, I don't remember the last time I made $50 on one YouTube video with thousands of views. Like, this is right. Ridiculous. Like, but I found out shortly that after you hit $100, it caps off so slow.
Yeah.
Like, making $100 on Instagram Reels is so easy. And then like to get to 200 is like 1 million views, but it only takes 10,000 to make $100. Like it's crazy.
That always, yeah. So it's more about pushing like a high volume. They want you to create a lot of videos, not singular videos that go viral, right?
Depends. I think some people's strategies are different. I've seen Instagram like content creators have 1 million view on one reel. They won't post for a while, you know? It really depends how much reach your views or videos are actually getting. Like I know YouTubers, I've seen YouTubers that only post like once a month, but their views are like millions because the quality is crazy.
Right.
And so they just make so much money off of one video. So I guess it depends. You could pump out lots of small viewed videos and still make the same amount of money. It just depends on how you want to go about it.
So everything right now, and you guys are obviously killing the real thing, and I saw you have your TikTok, and obviously with YouTube Shorts, just like the minute and a half video thing, I don't think lends well to a chunk of music or to like a snippet, a vignette of behind the scenes. Like it lends well to the content you're already capturing. So it's like you can take longer form content, turn it into a ton of reels, and then you're just like bah, 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 making sure it's coming out in a way where it's like you're giving credit to each group and it's not like super homogenous. It's all Blue Devils and, you know, Pulse or whatever. But right. When we think about YouTube is really awesome because of the length of the videos. Like I like watching podcasts on YouTube, or I watch a lot of skate videos because they're free, and it's like Nike SB or Trans World comes out with so many, you know, or Thrasher is coming out with all these videos. So it's like, when I think about what you guys do, are you currently doing long form, like documentary style? Is that something you're looking into? Because I could see you guys taking over like what ESPN tried to do, what, you know, that Cadets, Blue Devils, The Rock weird thing maybe was.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
There's almost like a space. There's like a longer form space that you're talking about on YouTube. I don't know if that's already happening, but that's definitely a great area. And it's one I like. I like a little bit longer form personally. So what have you been thinking about that in terms of YouTube and video length?
Yeah. YouTube next year is going to be a bigger like focus. I think we focused a lot on Instagram. And I think we solidified the content in terms of how we get the Instagram content, which is the takeovers. What I have been doing is all the long form contents that we make, like the lot videos or like some of the interviews and just some of the creative bigger projects that we do all go on YouTube, and those get cut up on Instagram. So I think like Instagram is going to be okay. We don't focus on it as much because of what we've done already. And it's just a great medium, right? Like I think people are on Instagram to talk to people more often than like Facebook nowadays.
Right.
So, you know, having that close connection with the fan base, especially since we have so many on Instagram, it's going to be really important for us to like still be on there and make sure that's still growing. But in terms of growing the actual brand and because money is going to be a factor, right? I think YouTube has a bigger net in terms of how much money we can make because of the long form content and the shorts that will soon be monetized. And just like you, I like listening to podcasts too. And there's definitely a lot being planned in this moment of the year that we're going to push next year. So long form content is still something we're heavily going to be invested in. Lot videos are still going to come out, and the lot videos are cool because we try not to just do lot videos. Like I try to push getting mic'd in the lot. I know a lot of people like are kind of weird about that, but
they are weird about it.
Yeah, it is. And I always have a I always have a little hinge on my shoulder, like, dude, I don't want to. It's good.
What's the problem, though? I can't. When people say they don't want to get mic'd up in the lot, what do they say?
They don't really have a problem with it. It's more like, I don't think they want to tell me what the problem is. Like, I don't want to. It's either an insecurity of, like, I don't want people to hear what I'm saying to the kids, or like, I don't want that, like, hanging over my head because of what I said. And I get that. Like, I think some people want to go and teach and just be comfortable and, like, just, like, want to run their group like they're used to. But, like, being on a mic and camera, just, I get it. It's different. So I still try to push it, and I do get rejected sometimes. And it's kind of hurtful, but it's okay. It's all for the love of the activity.
Well, you always know you can mic up GMU staff.
Yeah, dude, GMU was fun, man. I still talk to John and them about that time. Just like, even when we interviewed you in the tent, and he, like, got your shoes and everything. Those are some of my highlights of that trip. It's just, GMU's vibe has been awesome. I've always been a huge fan.
Dude, that's crazy. The fact that you marched Pulse, and, you know, it was awesome when you guys hit me up, and I had been following you guys, obviously, and just like, oh, this is like a good Instagram account. You don't really think, like, what's going on behind the scenes or whatever. But when you guys hit me up, I was like, dude, like, if we have West Coast guys that have nothing to do with what we do, it's not like we march together, you know, I didn't teach you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the people I teach, like, they get it. They're on the inside of it. But when it's like, you know, and it's more so you personally as your background and where you come from, then it is like, oh, you're the dude who runs this big ass platform. I'm all about it. Like, I'm always down to collaborate. You already know, and we should definitely do that, and we will. But it's like, to have fans in like you or John coming through, it's like, we like what GMU is doing. And it's like, okay, that tells me I am doing something right, because I want fans from Pulse and from Vanguard and from groups that I have nothing to do with. I didn't march. I'm not in, like, not that I'm not influenced by it, but I didn't receive the direct influence of as a member.
Yeah.
So it was just super cool, because it's like, dude, like, I just want to have fans. I want people to understand what we're doing artistically and connect with it. And it's like, I feel like sometimes you guys and the fans in the, you know, out there get it more than the judges do, which, you know, I don't know what to feel about that. In some way, it's flattering. I'm not sure.
Yeah, no, I've always been a fan. I think the style of GMU and your influence to that group has been cool to watch, like, from afar. Cause, like, I get influenced by groups that I'm near, and then I hear about people around it, and then that has an influence, and then some people don't like it, and that has an influence. But I like being far away from groups and just seeing them and going, cool, I like that. That's tight, you know? So that was kind of the vibe I got from GMU, because I don't, you know, I'm not close with anyone at GMU. Like,
yeah,
I've met you online, I met you in person, but, like, I didn't, like you said, I didn't teach or march with you or anything. And I actually used to watch you when we were still at Cavaliers. I think I was that 2011 or 2012?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, 10,
I was 11. Like, yeah, I was like my first year and a half in, like, drumming, marching, percussion. I was just like, oh, we're all these cool. So it's just been cool to watch from afar, and you've been awesome, and you've always been very welcoming and a nice guy. So it just helps to the whole idea that GMU's created, and it's been cool, man.
Dude, I appreciate that. It's like, I don't know, I guess because I do this, so I have put a lot out there. Not everything, of course. Like, you could never understand, not you, but one could not understand what it's like to be in my shoes, go through a season or go through the last 10 years that I've been doing. But I feel like there's so few people that are at the level that I'm at, designing, especially for indoor drumline now, and taking a stake in it in the way that, like, our team has, and then is willing to talk about it in a space that's not like the advisory board with all the doors closed. And I've tried to be a person who is like, yo, like, this is how I've gotten here, this is what I've gone through, and this is continuing what I go through, and being very transparent about that. And not everyone likes that, and not every ensemble likes that. Mason certainly has always been so cool about everything that we do, and, like, is the most supportive organization you can imagine. But it's like, dude, I want to know, like, all right, like, what does it take, you know, Ian Grom to do what he does? Like, I know he does interviews, but he's always being interviewed. He's not necessarily, you know, he's always in that seat. So it's like, I just don't know him to that extent. I always use him as an example because he's such, like, a perfect product of arranging and composition and professionalism. And it's like, I want to see behind the scenes with him and, like, what they do and what him and John do, like, you know, with Box Six. I should just ask them to do an interview because I haven't.
Yeah.
They're super professional. You know what I mean? And like, I seek to be professional and of course all those things, but also like, I don't know. It's like, you want to hear the coach mic'd up on the field.
Yeah, for sure, man. I understand that.
And it's like, oh, when you catch them swearing, you catch Bill Belichick bugging out in the field. You're like, oh damn. Like these players, like, you know what it takes to be at the level that we see the kids being at is they can deal with that at times. Deal with the roughness, deal with just the difficulty of the day-to-day. And it's like, it provides you that insight that we talked about before. But anyway, that's all to say, I am literally always down to like throw the doors open to you guys. Like it was super sick. Like our members got, you know, that venue is terrible, but our members finals week got you guys coming through, setting the cameras up, and it gave them, it told them that they mattered more than just me telling them. I, of course, tell them that all the time and that what we're doing is special, but it was like, look, they're here and I did not book this. Like you guys took your time to capture us in some of our final moments and they're going to have that to watch forever. Like that's super dope. It must feel cool in your shoes to like create that for other people now. And the way you talked about creating it for yourself.
Yeah, man, you brought up a lot of good things that just like blew up in my head. Because the first thing I will say is when you say like when people are in the midst of the grind and they just say things like, because I've mic'd up quite a few people already, it's funny because I don't release everything and I shouldn't release everything. But when I get to edit everything, it's like, did I hear that right? That's fucking funny. You know, like I've heard people say things. I'm like, that's cool. You're human. I get it. But like, when you look at them in a professional light, you would never think they'd say something like that. And I totally understand that. Like it really puts the rawness of like what we do in perspective. Cause like, we're all just humans trying to make it happen. And that's one of the things that actually I get a lot of like credit for in terms of marching blogs. Like I get DMs every once in a while. And sometimes during specific periods, like the end of the season where they just come. And they say, dude, you help me see how like normal these people are. Like, it's not so intimidating. Like you've encouraged me to go audition, you know, like you let me get over that hump of being afraid to be around people that, you know, they're so good at drums. Like, cause that is intimidating. Like I remember still learning how to drum and trying to do that. I'm just like, I can't do that. That's intimidating, you know? So it's been a pleasure to hear that from people. And what else did you say? You said, oh, the GMU thing. Yeah, man. I think when we got there and John and I and Ben were just talking about how cool GMU is. And like, you definitely don't have to tell your members that. Cause I guess we should do that more because it's just cool, man. They like to see what GMU has been doing and the vibe. And I love the way you guys play the drums. Like the style is just so cool. And yeah, by the way, all that stuff's coming out. Like all the show stuff, that documentary that we were kind of like making. I'm still in the midst of editing everything. Like I got Monarch, I got GMU and Pulse. And Pulse is
so sick.
Pulse is gonna be a lot. It's just we followed them all the way down the tunnel and like to the moment where they like won and everything. So
that's so sick.
Yeah, I'm glad that I'm doing this for myself to watch, but I can only imagine how excited some people might be to like kind of see that's going to come out eventually. Because I've got messages, people, hey, when's that stuff coming out? Like even GMU members are like, hey, when are those videos coming out? And I always have to say like, it's in the works, it's almost there. Because it is a lot, man. Like I go through my hard drive and it's hours of footage just from one ensemble. And
oh, yeah.
And like to get myself motivated enough after like a long day teaching or even just working on other stuff, I'm like, oh, dude, I have to edit that. Okay, there we go.
You know, it's not easy at all. It is not, honestly, and especially when we're talking about drumming and sound and just you're trying to optimize and maximize everything so that when you put it out, this is the thing: is like it was however clean it was, but you can't make it seem dirtier, or you're gonna get someone knocking down your door like, hey, please. These edits are like exposing like this, this, and this that I don't want. So you have to just, I'm sure. And of course, being from the activity, you have a perspective on that. You're not like being flagrant and like, oh, like posting dirt reps, you know, even though like, if it is dirty, it's dirty. So I don't, it's not really your responsibility, but if you're, you know, I know the way people are when you're talking about the mic'd up thing, or we're talking about vlogging behind the scenes, like there's just honestly, like, it's hard to play clean. Like a lot of groups, like it's kind of okay until it's time to step up. And like, that's kind of a factor in what we do at the highest level, is like, you can't maintain the high level for 8 hours a day. It's just not something you can do. Now, you can reach levels of focus and clarity in 13 minutes of a DCI show. Like, I've done it and it is possible, but like, we weren't super clean all day, every day, you know? So I can imagine you're balancing that, like, oh, I need to like make sure that I'm presenting every group as well as I can. And that's like an artistic choice when you're in the editing seat, I would imagine.
Yeah, that resonates with me a lot, because the more I'm in the activity that as a viewer, right, the more like, and I marched, right? So I get it. I get what it's like to be in the seat and like trying to reach the cleanest possible moment. But the longer I'm away from being an actual performer, the more I realize, like exactly what you said, like it's so hard to play clean. Like our ears are so in tune now after, I think this is my fifth year being aged out, and like just hearing drums as a viewer, I can hear dirt, and it happens so much more than people realize. Like the cleanest groups are not even like piss clean. Like there's always something, and you might get that in like the actual final run,
right?
But like all the rehearsals leading up to it, like that's what makes them have that. It's all the mistakes that are happening. So I think when I get pushback from people that like don't want to get mic'd up or like say, oh, that's dirty or something, I take that with a grain of salt, because like, is it actually like that dirty? Okay, it is. Yeah, I get it. We'll scrap it. But if it's like, you know, little bits of clarity issues during a lot, like, come on, man, people are gonna be watching, you know, like in person, you can't edit that out of their ears, you know? So almost like, what's the difference if I put it online? I guess it gets stamped forever, but also you're presenting your ensemble. So if you're ready, you're ready, you know? Like if you're not, then what's another like rehearsal gonna do to that if you're already at the end of the season, you know? So it's one of those things, like I don't think I hear clean as much as I used to when I was not tuned to the drumming. You know what I mean?
No.
Like, so
it's over. Those days are gone.
Yeah.
Those days are gone. You're on the other side of it. Like I remember, you know, we talk about this sometimes too, is like I remember watching like Cavaliers 2002 when I was, you know, in high school, because I started marching in 05. That was my first year drum corps. So I'm like, you know, I'm a little bit older than you, but it was like, I remember seeing 2002 Cavaliers. I was like, this is perfect. Like marching Cavaliers, and then watching the videos of Frameworks, I'm like, they are awful. Like that is a bad year for them, you know, considering the era they were in too. And it was like, whoa, like, you know, you get on the other side of it and it's just you see it differently is what I would say. Mm-hmm. You know, it becomes so granular and technical, and you know, I just don't believe totally in like the withholding till the perfect moment. And I know some people, that's very much their vibe with their group, is like, we're not gonna like show this until like we're ready, we're in control of our narrative. And like, I think that's fine. I also think like when you watch basketball, they're missing shots, but they just keep going, and it's like, yo, you're gonna miss some shots, but it's like, you don't turn the broadcast off because like they're missing a free throw. Like, I don't think that's leading to like an improvement in the overall culture. I think it's like more of the artistic side of things. And people are very like, I'm going to roll this out to my pleasing. And that's fine. You can do it any way you want. I like the transparency. I like working with you guys. I like working with FloMarching or whomever. Drum Corps Coffee Shop's another one that shows a lot of love. West Coast guys, and they're just like doing their thing, but it's like, yo, come inside, like I want to show that process, you know? So again, after we get off, we'll talk about how we can do that with Mason. But sure. So while we're, you know, kind of in the back half of the interview here, I want to just hear sort of like, because we've talked a little bit more about how you've built the brand and kind of how you sustain it and your vision for it, at least up to this point. What do you like about social media? Like, what's the thing that's drawn you? What's the thing that's made you naturally equipped to be pretty successful at it? I'd say 100K is success, especially in the marching space. What do you like about it? And then what are some things that you would change about it?
That's a tough question. It's kind of like hate the game, not the player, and that's kind of what I'm doing, because like I have my love and hate relationship with social media, and I battle with this throughout my days all the time, because now that I'm building a brand and I've been in it for like 4 years, I can't tell you how much I hate being on my phone as much as I am. Like it really is kind of a distraction. So I guess the biggest thing I hate about social media is how much like everything is built for you to be addicted. And what I love about social media is that there's two sides to that, right? You could be the consumer or you could be a producer, which is what I'm trying to be more of, less of a consumer, more of a producer. And it gives me like some sort of purpose with people I don't have direct reach to. So that's probably the biggest reason why I love social media. But the downfall of it is like, it's just, I could be easily a consumer. And I can only imagine what that's like for people who don't have like a brand or something they're doing on social media, people that are just kind of stuck in the loop. And it's all about balance, but yeah, to answer your question, those are the two things I'd say.
Great answers. Honestly, those are more, I'd say cogent than what I'd probably be able to say, but I think that was super on point. For you in your seat, having some success in building this brand, what makes someone a good content creator in your eyes? Like, how do you personally measure success? Obviously there's like the data analytics and there's the tools you can use just to see kind of like what works and what doesn't, but then there's also the instinct portion. Like for you, are you instincts driven? Are you data driven? What would make someone the ideal content creator so they could build a brand like you have?
See, the thing is, I don't think I'm that much of an ideal content creator. Like I think I'm doing is cool, but I don't know that I'm like, I could sit down in front of a camera all the time and like produce content like that. And I think that's what actually makes a good content creator, is because they could tell a story with themselves and constantly create through just like their words and paint stories. Like some of the people that I follow online all the time have this incredible knack to create a story with their voice. And that's something I actually want to try and tackle in the future. So I'll update on that in a couple of years, probably. but what makes someone a good content creator, I'd say, is to have a niche, have a following that actually cares about what you're doing, and kind of just sticking to the mission that you started with, or at least are trying to uphold. So those are some things that I try to keep in my head as I make Marching Vlogs content. Am I giving like the viewer something that they actually want to watch? Is it because it's what I want to watch? Most likely, because I'm just a big fan. So I kind of use that, and that's, I guess, to tap onto what you're asking, that's kind of where the instinct is, right? Like I am a performer educator in the marching arts. So I am involved in some way that I understand how things move and operate. I can see where the attraction to the marching arts is. I can see where people dislike the marching arts. So in terms of instinct and like making the right choices and what to make and stuff, that's kind of where I fall, right? Because I'm involved. In terms of the metric stuff, I think it's cool that like I've reached such a feat of 100,000, but it doesn't feel any different than it was at like 8,000-9,000, to be completely honest with you. It's just like a huge ego boost, like, oh wow, I built this brand up to 100K. But more so, the more question to me is like, what am I doing with it, you know? So I guess that's what I'm trying to do, is just continue to push the mission that I've been building since the beginning, which is to bridge the gap between performers and the members and the viewers and, you know, everyone involved, to just kind of close that gap. So I think that's what makes me a good content creator for the marching arts. And I think if anybody else wanted to make content for the marching arts, I think they would have to do the same. I see a bunch of people like Forte Athletics, Drum Corps Coffee Shop, you know, all these brands that are actually making a good name for themselves, and they're tackling just that. Forte Athletics is really good about putting together content that helps people get, you know, closer to their goals. So they have that mission behind them. I think the metrics and stuff is just a good tool to let you know if you're on the right track. And sometimes it can even be deviating. Like I kind of mentioned earlier, like not everyone that follows Marching Gloves is a marching person.
Right.
That's totally okay. But sometimes people watch because of, my mind goes to a video that I don't really want to highlight, but it's probably one of our most viewed videos. And I wouldn't even say that I would support the actions that were happening inside that video. So it's like, I'll just tell you, it was the time when somebody threw a stick in a drum head. Like somebody broke a drum head with their stick.
Was that, and, well, Drew Guy did that in one of his INEs, 2011, I believe.
Yeah, for sure. And
someone just did that in a rehearsal. They just stabbed the drum head.
Yeah, and they got a video of it, but they were changing the heads. So it's like, it was a broken head to begin with. It was it was kind of like a funny thing that somebody recorded and got. And I thought it was funny because he's changing the head, broken anyway. Let's post this video. And it like got so many views. But what I came to realize is like the comments are full of people who don't understand the marching arts that were negatively like portraying what was happening, which makes sense. Like if I didn't know what was happening, why would this guy just destroy a perfectly good drum head? You know, but it wasn't a perfectly drum head. They were changing the head. It was already pulled and broken. But like you kind of have to be in the marching arts to know that. So, you know, the metrics of like how much we're getting in terms of viewership and all that can be, you know, it could be deviated. It doesn't necessarily mean it's like successful.
That video example is such a perfect point because the reality is your data and your metrics could be skyrocketing. You know, I'm thinking about like Kim Kardashian, you know, or like Ronaldo. But so their data, their numbers, their videos, their monetization's there. But you've got to think that a large portion of it, if not more than 50%, might be completely negative reactions to the content. So it's like you have to deal with like, I am going to sort of go forth and create this and build my platform. I like what you said about maintaining a mission. I think that gives you an idea of always what you're going back to and what the purpose is. But it's like, if you want to succeed, you might be dealing with the negative backlash if it's broad enough content to reach out there, right? Because people, like, they don't get it. Like there's a question there. So it's like, it's kind of hard to, you know, make sense of. And it's like, you can't, if you want success online, there's always going to be almost like 50% of like people just like shit talking on it, which is not sure what to do about that. It's just like kind of the nature of it, I would guess. I've been not reading much of the comments on YouTube because people just like, you know, that's a nature. For some reason, that's the nature of YouTube specifically, is very like criticism driven. So, but it's like, who cares? You know, if your numbers are good, like whatever, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I think sometimes it's a moral dilemma almost, because like you could be putting something that you don't agree with, but it will get the most reactions because it's very controversial. So it's sometimes, I mean, I don't come across that too often, but like I said, with that video, it sometimes does happen. Like I've definitely gotten a lot of pushback on that video because people reach out to me and go like, hey, dude, like I heard some kid was doing this. And I'm like, dude, the influence is not in the right direction. Like, is this okay? Like, so I guess how I battled that is just like kind of thinking like, okay, I'm adhering to the people that actually want to see the content. Like I'm focusing on like, this was supposed to just be a funny thing. And now I have to put disclaimers on like, this is a broken head. Like you need to not do this at your high school.
I mean, this is the nature of viral things though. It's like, you don't get to decide what it means and like who it influences and like, why are you responsible for some kid breaking a new head? Right. Like that's not your responsibility. Like the one chip challenge and then someone's dying. And it's like, yo, like the video didn't possess you. Like, you know, like there's like blame the parents. Like, because the kid has no critical thinking skills. Like you're not responsible for that. Like, I kind of don't think you need to worry too much about that. If you were like, if you posted something that was slanderous, or if you post something that represented another brand or like an organization wrong, there's no question. But it's like drumhead manufacturers that are in our activity understand that the heads change very frequently. And we know these people, they wouldn't be like, you're portraying Evans badly because that's an Evans head. Like it's all good. Like drum heads break, they're made to break.
Right. Yeah. I agree with you. I think that's why I still kind of just post it anyway. Cause I believe in that more so than just like not posting it for the sake of like trying to shelter some people or like putting the fault on myself. Cause I know that I'm not at fault. It's just, like I said, it's more like a moral dilemma. Like, do I have this much influence to like change how people act towards their instruments? Like, something to think about, you know? And not to say that that weighs on heavily, but it's definitely there.
Well, I think your responsibility in that way is less about what's in the content and who you represent. So if you are a content company like yourselves and you only are giving access to Blue Devils, Vanguard, Boston, and Blue Coats,
yeah,
no other core gets to do takeovers and you don't film any other core, that's where I would be like, hey, like you're not representing this accurately, because like those are four cores of the most well-funded, richest drum cores, probably. I'm not, the budget's in front of me. If someone wants to holler at me, I'm sure there's a relationship there, but it's like, you don't do that, right? You're very cognizant of like giving insight and giving access to cores of all competitive levels. And that's the type of thing that I think would be more of like a blind spot than like, oh, like, why would you break a drum head? Like, why would you? Okay, there's like, okay, why would we march sideways and crab when it's going to hurt all of our hips later? Why would we, like, we're allowed to make these choices. Like, it's not that big of a deal. But I think it seems to me like you guys have your head wrapped around like how you represent the activity fairly across a variety of spectrum, highs, lows, and in betweens.
Yeah, you pretty much hit it. I mean, we're just trying to be good people in the good activity. You know, so, and that gives me some reassurance too. It makes me feel better about just putting stuff up, because it's not going to be my fault.
I know. And dude, it's tough because the reality is like the top groups get the most views. So that, I mean, you're going to produce quality content across the board. Like I was watching some video of mandarins earlier. I was like, oh, like this makes mandarins look really good. Like, in general, and it's like, they weren't bad, you know, they're not a top three drum line, but they are good, and you're showing that they are good, right? But I have to imagine like the groups that win, the, you know, the powerhouses, the brand name drum corps and indoor drum lines, like that's just how this works, right? So you almost take a hit when you go like, hey, I'm gonna film this open class group, like we're gonna put these groups, you know, and blast them out there, and it's like you might not get as many views, but I think you're gonna earn the trust and the viewership and the subscription of people who are in those groups. And that does matter a lot. You know what I mean? Like that you are showing them because they are there, and there's good stuff in open class, and there's good stuff in the lower end of DCI. And you don't really see that a lot. Same thing with front ensemble, you know, it's like a whole culture that hasn't grown as much yet. The drumline lot culture goes back to the like late 90s, the front ensemble video lot culture just isn't caught up yet. And like, that's something that people are always, so as much front representation, it's like the whole thing has not gotten there yet. I don't know what to do about that, because I'm not in the lot filming, but I think that conversation has been out there. I'm sure you've heard it already quite a bit.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that's true, man. That's a great thing to bring up to light, because the battery situation, like you said, has been around for a while and everyone hypes it up, but the front ensemble, they don't get as much love. And I don't honestly know why. I like the battery thing because I'm a battery. I'd assume if I was the same person that chose like front ensemble instruments, that I might have gone the same route. Like, you know, marching vlogs could have easily been more front ensemble heavy, but it's not, because I'm not. And that kind of ties into to another idea I have with marching vlogs, and continuing that mission is like trying to expand the people involved to be more representative of those sections. Because I definitely don't want to just be a battery thing. It's just, I take what I know and I bank on it, you know, like I can't bank on something that I have no experience or knowledge around. And so, you know, I try to tell some of my friends that are either getting into video photography that like are front ensemble people, like come help me shoot some front ensembles. Like, yeah, make that happen. But that's a very interesting point. Yeah. There's something I actually have thought.
Yeah, drumline thing goes back. There was like lothype.com. There was like drumline archives. There's like snare science, like all these, there's just a really like cult following of drumline people. One thing about the front ensemble that comes to mind is like, there, in my opinion, are probably a higher population of students in the front ensemble that are also percussion majors. So when they leave the activity, they're in a different side of the percussion house. We're like, these, you know, we're drumline jocks. Like, you know, I don't have a music degree or whatever. And it's like, I think a lot of drumline people leave and they like, they just love it and they don't do drumline anymore. And it maybe leads to a bigger culture of alumni that stay connected. It leads to a bigger viewership, a bigger turnout in the lot, people that were in the group or our fans. So I don't know, that might be baloney. I'm not exactly sure. I don't know much about that, but just thinking about, you know, the people I've taught, it's like, I think more of the front people are like classically trained percussionists that kind of just go off and do, you know, that side of thing. I don't know. Right. I could just be providing an excuse. Yeah.
No, that's a good point, because I think drumline people don't have another avenue. Like, battery is only marching percussion. Like, you don't see it at all, actually, in the concert setting. You know, you don't see those instruments there and the type of vibe that they have. But with the front ensemble, you have a similar world. You have, you know, standstill instruments that can also be put into a concert setting, or any other musical setting for that matter. Like, I think battery is such its own world, you know, because it's we move and play and it's just weird.
But well, it's dope. I think for you guys, like, the front ensemble thing would be a great area to expand into. I think you have the, you know, the ability there, and it's just a matter of like getting that consultation so it's authentic. Like you said, you're not going to want to do it like from a drumline person's perspective, but it's so similar. Like, you really, you know, I mean, I understand the kind of taboo. It's like, I'm a snare drum guy, so I can't like understand the front ensemble. I was like, dude, I could clean a marimba line. I'm telling you right now. I wouldn't teach the marimba line how to play four mallets, because I can't play four mallets. But from a rhythmic understanding, from how to get better in a rehearsal, I could clean a marimba line. I have. I'm not, you know, I think we need to, you know, take those barriers down between like what a marimba and a snare drum or bass drum, like, they're 98% exactly the same.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I agree. I think both sections, they have one similar responsibility, and that's timing. You know, and both have a secondary responsibility, which is why we're separate. One is moving and the other one is melodical contribution to the music. So, they're both just as equally important. I think you spot on with that. I teach at a high school and I'm the caption head there, and I also manage a front ensemble. So I totally agree. Like, I can't teach you how to play four mallets, but I sure can get you to rehearse well and make sure you're playing your rhythms right. So,
can you play an attack? Like, that's what's the same. Like, we've play physic, like, our physical thing that we do is so similar. And, you know, the front doesn't get as much love with the media thing, and the funny thing is that they're a more predominant force in the judged aspect on the field. One great example that I go back to, and this is just like facts, it's not my opinion at all, it's like, everyone was like, Boston's the favorite to win, and they got fourth. Because for what their front was doing, if you have to average the front and battery, if anything, way more heavily in the front, because they are the default to be judged, not the drumline. Because like you said, the drumline can go out here and do this and contribute to the visual aspect. And it's not that the front doesn't contribute to the visual aspect, but they're right there. So they're judged for a longer period of time and are more easily accessed. I think that people, because they see so many drumline videos, they're like, this is what's being judged. But like, the segments of the drumline exposures are really what is sampled on the field. And then when they're not, the front's got to be carrying a heavy ass load. And when they don't, you get that weird striation between like, Boston played like the hardest shit. And like, for most of the season, they were definitely the best. I think they struggled to keep up with their own product because it was so hard. Mm-hmm. So they might've had the best drumline. You could probably argue they were. I might argue vocabulary wise, athleticism, it was so badass. And then it was like that you have to average both sections, and that's what creates like the percussion score, right? Or same thing with indoor, is like, you see the book in the lot, you see the show, and it's like, you really need to be thinking about just the show. Like, GMU stuff in the lot last year specifically was like, okay, this is cool, like, whatever, in the context of the show, that's where it's at, and that's where it needs to be really assessed. And what we experience through the media outlets we have, and then what is actually assessed are not always the same. I think people kind of get trapped in like, well, I'm seeing this video and this is what I see, and that's my opinion. It's like, well, these groups don't even stand still. You know what I mean? Like, we move. You got to play well on the move. That's like the real.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I mean, that's something that like people love to judge a video online, and it's not even where it matters. Like, it matters to the culture maybe, but to like the actual result. And then funny enough, people try to like take what they saw in a video and then compare it to the score that actually comes out. It's like, dude, you were not there. And then you saw this video and you're putting two things together that just don't make sense. It's like,
even if you're in the stands, if you're there, you can see how things shake out. You can really tell, because like when I watch Pulse in the lot, they were like this good. And then when I watched them inside, they were like this good. And they were really good outside, but you could hear this stuff, right? And they all heard it too. Inside, they were perfect. I didn't hear a thing, right? So it's like, you can have understanding if you're live, but for DCI, if you're not on the field with the judge, you really have no clue what's going on. The drumline clarity and quality and trying to split first through seventh, like you really have to be in that seat. You almost don't understand it unless you are literally on the field doing it then with them. So it's tough because we want to get it. You know, we all want to be kind of, you know, the couch critic and like do the thing that sports people do. And it's even harder because we don't have like the play by play and we don't have, you know, the best thing we have is like, you know, the lot videos. And then of course, I mean, really like the, you know, the GoPro thing is cool. It doesn't allow you the full line clarity, but it definitely gives you the experience, which I think is really, really pretty awesome. Even though we get scared as instructors when, you know, Vic Firth comes around at the end and they're like, we're throwing the GoPro on. We're like, good. This better be good.
That's awesome.
So, so to wrap this up, if you could go talk to your, you know, former self, maybe your age out year or even younger, and you could kind of give yourself one piece of advice now that you know what you know, 100,000 followers on Instagram later, a brand built and building more later, what would you kind of tell your younger self?
Like younger as in the beginning of the brand or?
Yeah. Like, okay, I'm going to get into this and I don't really know what I'm doing. And now that you're sort of this many seasons in, this many years in, what would you, you know, what's the most valuable lesson that you learned that you, you know, would impart on yourself?
Well, I will start by saying, I don't know that I would want to change anything. I think everything's been naturally playing out like comfortably in the right, like I don't look back at marching vlogs and go, dang, I should have done that differently. I think that's a testament to how I like think about marching vlogs. Like I still to this day just keep asking myself, what can I do to prolong marching vlogs? Like, because I know that like businesses and brands just die because they just don't get any love or they don't get any efforts. So that's my biggest thing, is like making sure that I continue to think about what I can do to build the brand. So I don't know, just stick with it, be patient. That's what I'd say. There were frustrating moments for sure. Like there's been countless times where I'm like, is this worth my time? Do I want to keep doing this? But every time I push through that, I always get another reason why as to why I keep doing this, whether it be the people involved, like the networking. Like, I don't think I would have met you if I didn't do this. I wouldn't have gotten the job at Vanguard. I wouldn't have made the Marching Vlogs drumline, which, by the way, has been like totally one of my biggest endeavors that I've ever accomplished. And that only came through because I started marching vlogs. So I would probably just tell myself, like, dude, you don't know what's about to be ahead of you. Be patient, keep working, be consistent, you know, keep your head down and be proud when things come to fruition. So, yeah.
Love it, man. Well, this is super cool. I love getting to just like talk with people who are kind of in the mud with just doing the thing. You know, it seems so easy from the outside, like you have it rolling, you've got this following, and there's a natural flow and momentum to it now, but you had to go through the process of learning. You literally told me you didn't even get trained or really, you kind of are self-taught. So it's like just taking that chance is super cool, and it's awesome to see. Like, you know, I'm always trying to go behind the curtain, just learn more for what I'm doing, because what you're going through is what I went through with designing, or what I went through with teaching too. Like, we all kind of go through, like, I don't really know what this is, and then you just keep going until you're in it. So I'm a big fan of what y'all do, and you know, I'm looking forward to collaborating with you guys and miking up and getting the tripod set up and getting, you know, kind of capturing these moments that are just like super amazing. You know, I'm so excited to see that documentary you're talking about from last year's indoor. So we'll talk off camera about what the plans are that you maybe didn't want to share for the public. But sure. Dude, thank you so much for getting on here, and everyone help me thank Sergio, and thanks for listening. Subscribe, like, go follow Marching Vlogs across the various platforms we discussed on here. And Sergio, where can they find you on Instagram as well?
My Instagram is sergoboy, two Y's at the end, so S-E-R-G-O-B-O-Y-Y. You can pretty much find anything on there. I have links set up and everything to reach out to me, DM me. I have marchingvlogs.com. You can go there, check out what we have to offer. The website's set up in a way where you can kind of go through everything we've done in the past and it organizes in a way where you can reach out, whatever else. So yeah, marchingvlogs.com and Sergio Boy on Instagram.
Awesome. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next time. Peace.